My name is Kyle Renio. I'm in the Engineering Academy at CATA.
I'm Arlie Renio, mother of Kyle Renio.
And I'm Bruce Renio, father of Kyle.
My name is Alex Alamos. I am in the Engineering Academy at Central Academy.
My name is Jacob Dent. I also go to the Engineering Academy at CATA. Two other group members are Kyle Pinero and Sabrina Miles.
I want to be an astrophysicist when I grow up, so I was talking to one of my favorite teachers. His name is Mr. Hardy.
He mentioned rockets, and I asked him if he had ever built any rockets.
You know, he had planned to do a project with rockets, but just he couldn't find any students to do it. That's when he knew we were the right students.
And I think my role has a little bit more to do with mentoring than actually participating in any part of the club at all. It's just being a parent.
Yeah, supporting.
Right now we're working on a furnace.
We're using bricks, and we are caulking the bricks together in a mold, as one might say, through made of wood.
It's really exciting when you actually fire up the furnace. That's when it's fun.
The ultimate goal of the project is to create a model of Dr. Goddard's first
liquid-fueled rocket rather than a solid-fueled one, because liquid-fueled rockets are much more complicated and difficult to fly.
Kyle wants it to go out of orbit, but that's just a kind of a whatever goal. You know, if it happens, it happens.
I mean, they're getting a feel for what they have to do and adjustments they have to make. And hopefully, if they continue in college, I think they'll definitely succeed in that.
After high school, we're definitely going to continue working on this project.
Yeah, I think everyone should at some point try to get something into space.
My number one goal is that for the rocket to beat the weather balloon's altitude. The weather balloon will make it to 100,000 feet, which is near the edge of space.
The weather balloon is supposed to carry up the Raspberry Pi that we're going to collect data from the atmosphere for.
And we are going to test all of those components by releasing them and sending them up into the upper stratosphere.
Because we want to get the data ourselves, so we can say that we've done this project fully. You know, we don't want to ride on the backs of anyone.
I believe that if we keep working on it, it's going to happen, but it might take years and years.
I've always said shoot for the stars, because if you shoot and miss, at least you'll land on the moon, but if you shoot for the moon and miss, you'll burn up in the atmosphere.
Art breaks boundaries, as does creativity. But at what point does this come too far? Censorship keeps things in line so that they can be handled by the masses. In 2013, 417 books in the US were banned, 92 for sexually explicit content. In Cuthbertson High School, 20 out of 20 students are aware of what sex is.
In the early part of the 20th century, parents did not want their children exposed to sexually explicit content. You know, the Playboys were hidden under the mattress. But when sexual content addresses issues like domestic violence, incest, and rape, I feel like those are topics that we need to talk about.
I think that books should be given and assigned on an individual basis. I think that it should be, if they want to teach it or if they want to read it, then they should present it to the individual and with parent permission. And again, within school, I think that, again, the parents need to be brought in.
Second in line for the causation of banned books was bad language.
Well, I don't curse because that's sinful.
Yes, bad words are bad, but they can add to humor or tensity in a book or movie. And while movies are mentioned, let's get to a good point. The MPAA is responsible for overlooking the ratings of movies. In July of 1984, the rating of PG-13 was introduced. This was to be wedged in between an awkward place where something should not be PG but should not be R as well. Enacted with good intention, this is not the case, however. Film studios are pushing that films be PG-13 rather than R to create more revenue. In short, they're censoring the directors of their creative freedom just for money, possibly leading to cinema's downfall. And they can try, but they will not succeed. A concrete example of this is the fact that of the past 20 Best Picture winners of the Oscars, 70% were either rated R or not rated at all. Also, in 2015, R-rated movies made over $2.5 billion in the box office. A large reason for this is R-rated movie violence. Violence in films is wildly controversial, but it's sometimes more than unintelligent action. Looking at the movie Inglourious Basterds is a perfect example. The director, Quentin Tarantino, is widely known for his use of over-the-top violence. There's a little more to it though, especially in this movie. Within the film, a movie, called Nation's Pride, is shown to an audience. The movie is literally just repetitive killing and nothing but murder, but we get to watch the audience witness this, and they're having a great time. Representing the average audience of a violent film. Tarantino is essentially making fun of us. I covered the issue of censorship and lots of topics to do with the entertainment industry, but that's only where it begins, as it'll leak into our education. Censoring knowledge essentially brainwashes people so that they will do whatever they're told. The best part is that even this video could be censored as well, and I guess if that happens, I'm pretty much f***ed.
It's a unique sport. It's combined of running, strength, and agility all in one. Pole vaulting was not like it is today. You pole vaulted with a stiff pole. It did not bend. You had to use a aluminum pole, and before that, my brother has actually used bamboo. My brother Bob was a pole vaulter for Howe High School, and I got interested in it in grade school, but they didn't own a pole. So I went to Howe High School and tried it, and it made me happy. I started up a track team at Holy Spirit Catholic Church, and I got my son Keith interested in it to start with, and then my son Danny wanted to try it also, and both of them vaulted in grade school.
Well, I got interested in pole vaulting, I think when I was in eighth grade. I normally went over to my uncle's track practice so he could teach me how to pole vault. In high school, in a meet, I went 12-6. In practice, I went 13 feet, and then I put the bar up to 13-6, and then I shattered my pole. Yeah, I think pole vaulting began with my Uncle Bob, and then my dad followed kind of behind him, and so he became a vaulter. So it's kind of been in our blood, and it's been passed down through the generations, and I just kind of felt the need to get Liz involved in it, since she was good in gymnastics, and I thought it'd be a good crossover sport for her. I became her coach her sophomore year, and just with my background vaulting in high school and college, I thought I could help out.
I guess I became a pole vaulter because I needed something athletic to do, and then my dad did pole vaulting, so he kind of influenced me to try it. I vaulted 11-6 before. I guess winning 2 state titles is a big accomplishment, and qualifying for nationals, and then obviously getting accepted to college and getting a scholarship. My dad played a big role in my pole vaulting career. He was there to coach me along the way, and as well as my grandfather was my dad's coach, so it's kind of running in the family. And even my grandfather still comes and watches me at my meets even today, so it's really exciting.
Angelicus was the name of Brittany's imaginary friend when she was little. And when we were at the pet store and she saw Angelicus, she just was like,
It's Jellicus! We just couldn't leave her there, and it was just some sort of weird predestined thing that when I got her, it was just, that was our dog. First time we got her, I remember from videos that she ran out of her pen and jumped on me and started licking my face. And my parents were thinking, oh my gosh, she's gonna start crying, she's gonna freak out. But it wasn't, I was laughing. I thought it was the most funniest thing. She'd be laying on the couch, just taking a nap, and I love to play like a nurse or something. So I'd get my little nurse tools and stuff, and I would like play doctor on her.
I would love to take her to the park and play frisbee with her. And she would just jump up in the air. Like, she would like get air and get the frisbee. I always thought that was the most amazing thing.
The hardest part for me about losing Jellicus is that she was really sick at the end and having a really hard time breathing. But when we got on the floor and just looked in her eyes, it was like she was doing everything she could to stay alive for us.
It was really hard too. I decided to write it about her, just to kind of be thinking about her. This is actually what I wrote. Before I knew you, I knew your name. Just like a vision in dreams you came. We had connected before we had met. So what are the chances of you being my pet? I knew your color, I knew your eyes. So when I saw you, it was no surprise that I knew our love would grow to be something much bigger than just you and me. As we grew older, we grew together, and our deep love could handle whatever. In every moment filled with despair, I counted on you to always be there. I remember clearly when I would come home and walk on in, your wagging tail and dopey grin, my heart would jump from deep within. Who could have known that we'd find each other and turn out to have a love like no other? You made me laugh, you made me cry, and now I know there's no need for goodbye. I do believe you're watching over me, sitting, waiting, patiently. There's hope for both of us that we'll unite at morn or dusk, and on that day we will discuss our endless love, my Jellicus.
Don't like the way he uses the Force. It's not the way that Luke intended, and it is very, very violent. I just don't like it. It's not good.
I considered it an accident. The law considered it first-degree murder, but other than... Some people think being a Jedi is all fun and games. It's not. Sometimes you get a bad teacher. Luke?
Kylo, I trained Kylo. He's a good kid. He's just trying to find himself.
I mean, I just see him hanging around with this new group of kids. I mean, they're all a bunch of weirdos, honestly. I don't know what's gotten into him. He's just been wearing all black. Every time we take family trips to the mall, instead of going to the Gap, he's going to Hot Topic. It's very disappointing, I tell you.
Hello, m'lady.
Yeah, he's a good kid, but lately around him, I've been noticing a disturbance in the Force, and if I'm being honest, I feel like he might be getting swayed by the dark side.
Am I preparing for a fight? Oh, you know I'm preparing for a fight.
I think this is just a phase, you know? A growing teen. I love him so much. He's just a good kid.
I'm not wearing any underwear.
I can't believe it's come to this.
What do you mean?
Beautiful.
Ladies and gentlemen, welcome to episode 8.
Scott Hickey. I'm a former member of the NYPD. I'm a third generation police officer. So many Irish Americans are in the NYPD because when the Irish first came over at the turn of the last century, there weren't many jobs available to the Irish. And back then, being a police officer was probably one of the worst jobs you could have. It was the most dangerous. It was very bad paying. So the Irish were able to, were the people that would do the job. A lot of people didn't want to do it. I think because the Irish first started in the NYPD, they feel that they built it up into what it is today, and it's become a point of pride amongst the Irish to become a NYPD officer. That, you know, they're making their family proud, continuing the tradition. And now it's much better paying and a safer job than it was back then.
No, I didn't fear for his safety. I think he kept me in the dark at the time. He didn't share a lot of the bad things. He, afterwards now, he'll tell me things that had happened, and I'm glad I didn't know at the time.
Some of the rewarding aspects are when most of the time you see people at their worst, but then there's moments when you see them at their best.
Back in the day, there were no cell phones, so I really never knew was or what he was doing.
There were a few times I delivered babies, which is always a positive thing. You don't really go to work thinking that today I'm going to deliver a baby, but in the NYPD, that could happen.
I supported him in his choice to become a police officer.
Actually, it was for the pay was good and the benefits were good. I was just getting married and my father was a police officer and I saw how he was able to retire at an early age and support his family. It was, he would tell some pretty fun stories, so I thought it might be a good job to take, so I did.